Now presenting our chairman, John Parker.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for being here. First, I want to address the elephant in the room, is that this is not a debate. It was planned to be a debate, but unfortunately, due to a variety of unfortunate factors outside of either Mr. Tom Rand's or Mr. Alex Epstein's control, we had to convert this into a lecture. Both parties did everything in their power to make the debate happen. Unfortunately, it was simply not possible, and as chairman and as leader of CRs, I take most of the blame for that. However, just because Tom Rand is not here does not mean that Mr. Alex Epstein will not be facing resistance. So as I say, I expect sharp, biting questions during the Q&A to explore these ideas, because opposition is the only way we really get to the heart of things. Second off, I want to say thank you to everybody who helped make this happen. Our team at the student engagements were absolute godsends, working with the university, helping working with us. This event would not have been possible without them, so thank you very much. Thank you to our faculty advisor. Thank you to my e-board, who support me and helped make this possible. And thank you to YAF, of course, for helping sponsor, and ETS for making us all look very good. I also want to say a couple of things about decorum. I here have the university's policy on this. Syracuse University's mission states that in part of the university aspires to prepare engaged citizens, scholars, and leaders for participation in a changing global society. At the heart of every thriving college and university is the principle that ideas should be openly discussed, challenged, and defended. Universities are often referred to as the marketplace of ideas, where diverse perspectives collide, merge, and evolve. Let us approach tonight's event with open minds and a willingness to engage in a respectful dialogue. By doing so, we uphold the principles of free speech that are vital to our society's progress, and our intellectual perspectives can be heard. We are lucky to be an institution that permits this, and we ask you all to be respectful of tonight's event and our participants and guests. Of course, respect does not mean not challenging, so again, feel free to ask whatever you like. I also want to say that I forgot one thank you, and that is thanks to all of you for being here. Because you're here, I know that you are all intellectually curious and courageous people, which is something that I feel is in short supply these days. Each and every one of you being here is a true inspiration and an encouragement to me, and I know to the entire club. So thank you for being here. Thank you for watching along with the thousands of people who will be watching this stream. And thank you for supporting the continuation of the interest of ideas. But that's enough with the boring stuff. Time for the main event. So without further ado, I want to introduce you to the founder and president of the Center for Industrial Progress, an energy issue consultant on Capitol Hill, and New York best-selling author of The Moral Case for Fossil Fuels and Fossil Future, which you can get for free right over there, Mr. Alex Epstein.
Everyone, so, and everyone watching, so sorry it isn't a debate. I'm sure you guys are bummed. I'm sure you're not as bummed as I am about it. So just to give you context here, over the last 16 years, I've been thinking a lot about this issue, and I've developed a way of thinking about energy policy that I'll talk about that I think makes a lot of sense, and I haven't really seen anyone be able to refute, and I've worked really hard to learn all the relevant facts. And I've really become convinced that this very popular idea of net zero by 2050 is a really bad idea, and that we need a very different policy, which I call energy freedom. I've been able to persuade a lot of people and influence a lot of people, but the net zero position is still by far the mainstream position. And so one thing I've tried to do wherever I can is try to get leading spokespeople for net zero to debate. And it's just been harder and harder and harder over the years. Sometimes people back out. So I was supposed to debate Leonardo DiCaprio's main guy. He backed out. I was supposed to debate Michael Mann, one of the leading climate scientists and activists. He backed out. And then often people will come to a debate, but they won't actually debate the net zero position. They'll back off because they're having too much difficulty actually arguing for net zero by 2050, even though they do that publicly. So I was super excited by Tom being willing to come, because he is a smart guy. He knows quite a bit about energy technology, and he's somebody who really does seem to believe in net zero by 2050, very aggressive policies, as I'll talk about. And he really seems to believe that he can refute my arguments. In fact, he's quite colorful about this. So here's a quote.
"You're an intellectual fraud, and I really enjoyed ripping you to shreds in Climate Capitalism," that's his book, "although to be honest, it felt a bit like stepping on a mouse." So, seems like a confident guy. I didn't want to diminish his confidence, so I didn't have the heart to tell him that his whole account in his book was so poorly researched that he didn't even get my name right. He called me Ken Epstein twice, so I really wanted him to come. But I thought, like, this would be great. We'd get a smart and confident advocate of net zero going against my view, and then you guys would get to see my strongest arguments and their strongest arguments. So obviously, we don't have that. Tom isn't here. Now, as far as I can tell, he wanted to be here, but he isn't here. And just as somebody who's a professional speaker, I've never missed a speech. I've never missed a debate. I would move heaven and earth if anything got in the way. Whatever happened contractually, Tom signed those contracts. And so I wrote on Twitter, "Once again, a climate catastrophist has failed to show up for debate against me after agreeing to do so," which is true. And then I said, "Consistent with the low ethics of virtually every climate catastrophist I've dealt with, none of the three, including Tom, have apologized to me for bailing on the debates they agreed to, in which I spent a good deal of time preparing for." So right before this, I just wanted to make sure, okay, maybe now Tom has apologized. I would for sure apologize to anyone, including my worst enemy, if I wasted their time this way. And his response was, "That is not the reason for the cancellation." I didn't give a reason. "You are lying and you know it, you lying sack of shit." So he did not apologize. So we don't have a debate, which I really wish we did. But what I can do, and what I think will be really valuable, is I'm gonna give you my argument against net zero and for energy freedom, but I'm going to address every single plausible counter-argument that anyone can make, and I have extensively researched Tom's particular arguments. I'm gonna quote him quite a bit, always in context. That's the best I can do. So I'm gonna try to make the best case for the opposite side as well as the best case for mine, and you can see how they stack up, and then of course go read the relevant works and read my book and read other things and see what you think. So let's jump right in. Okay, so the overall, and by the way, I said 30 to 45 minutes. Since I'm gonna be addressing counterarguments, it's gonna be more like 45 to 50. So let's jump in with why we should reject net zero policies and embrace energy freedom policies. So the overall idea in our society is that the best policy toward fossil fuels and their CO2 emissions is net zero by 2050. And I'm gonna argue that the net zero policies have first already been catastrophically destructive when barely implemented, and then if fully implemented, they would be apocalyptically destructive, and they should be abandoned in favor of energy freedom policies. So let's talk about net zero policy and energy freedom policy. The key idea of net zero is it has a couple elements. One, the main element is by 2050, we're adding no CO2 and other greenhouse gases to the atmosphere. And the main way that's achieved is the rapid elimination of fossil fuel use. There are some ways we could theoretically capture the CO2 from fossil fuels, but almost no one thinks we're gonna do enough of that to reduce, to be able to use a lot of fossil fuels. So we need to rapidly eliminate them. That's certainly Tom's view, and that's my view if we want to achieve net zero. And a key element of this is it's a coercive view. So the idea is that we should be forced in one way or another to do this. And the more honest net zero advocates advocate very aggressive policies. So for example, Tom has publicly said that he advocates or is in favor of a $1,000 per ton carbon tax, but he laments that it's, quote, politically impossible. Those are his terms. So that would mean in Texas that you would pay 5 times more for gasoline, that in West Virginia you would pay 10 times more for electricity, that around the country you'd pay 4 or 5 times more for natural gas. These are very aggressive policies people are advocating. So that's what net zero is, very aggressive, coercive policies to rapidly eliminate fossil fuel use over the next 27 or so years. Now, energy freedom, on the other hand, when you contest net zero, there can be an idea that, oh, you just only care about fossil fuels. And here's a quote from Tom: "Epstein is a classic case of the fossil fuel apologist, someone for whom, whatever the problem, the solution is to burn more fossil fuels," unquote. So this is not at all true. Energy freedom is not about favoring fossil fuels in particular. It's about believing in the freedom of all forms of energy to be produced and consumed as people judge best, and having reasonable laws against pollution. So energy freedom policies include things like liberating nuclear energy, which is the thing I spend quite a bit of time on, liberating geothermal energy, even allowing solar and wind to perform to their best potential, but as long as, in my view, as long as they're delivering reliable electricity. We'll talk about today, they get a lot of favoritism that doesn't require them to deliver reliable electricity. So that is the basic policy I'm arguing for energy freedom, and in particular, not rapidly eliminating fossil fuels. So anything that Tom or anyone else would say about, hey, there's an exciting technology here, exciting technology there, I am very enthusiastic about that. And if they're getting blocked by some anti-freedom thing, I will absolutely help them make it possible. So it's not about being against those things. I'm enthusiastic about those. But I'm also very enthusiastic about people being free to use fossil fuels, because for the foreseeable future, I believe that's the only way that billions of people can get the energy they need to have really good lives. So one basic myth about net zero is that net zero policies are new and exciting. So you'll often hear somebody say, hey, I've got this exciting new plan, you know, we're gonna get to net zero, et cetera. I think it's really important to know that net zero policies have been implemented just a little bit, and they've already caused catastrophic energy shortages, just with minuscule implementation. So net zero, the goal is to rapidly reduce and eliminate fossil fuel use. They haven't even reduced it yet. They've just slowed the growth, and that's caused huge problems. And very importantly, the advocates of net zero did not warn us of these problems. So people like Tom Rand, but fill in the blank, everyone else, Michael Mann, all these people, none of them warned that when we pursued net zero policies and started restricting the growth of fossil fuels, let alone reducing it, we would run into problems. But we have run into some very, very serious problems already. So, and this is starting to get people to question net zero. Just out of the UK today, there was some news about they're walking back some of their net zero stuff. So in the US, one of the most conspicuous things is, after we've shut down a lot of reliable fossil fuel power plants, which we were told would work totally fine, we've been having more and more electricity shortages around the country. Texas, California warning all the time, we don't have enough electricity. This didn't used to happen nearly as much. I live in California, and right after Gavin Newsom declared, hey, we have to use all EVs starting in 2035, he said, don't charge your EVs because we don't have enough electricity. And when we drive around in the summer, it says, hey, don't use your air conditioning because we don't have enough electricity. So we have real power shortages, which are pretty obviously connected to these net zero anti-fossil fuel policies. In the European Union, it's even worse because they have restricted their domestic fossil fuel industry, and they thought they could get away with just having solar and wind, but it turns out they still need fossil fuels, but they've become much, much more dependent on Russia, as we've seen. And maybe, and the worst thing of all that hasn't been publicized enough is because we've had shortages of fossil fuels due to these policies, the poor nations have been hit the worst, because what happens is the wealthier nations will buy up the fossil fuels in a shortage, drive the prices up, and places like Bangladesh can't afford them, and that affects things like their ability to keep the lights on. So people are waking up to the idea that there are some problems with net zero. And I think at the root of it is one really wrong way of thinking about it. And I think this is pervasive. And you'll often hear it in the form of, you know, they'll say, we need to be net zero by 2050, or they'll often say as soon as possible. So I've heard Tom talk about, okay, well, it might be 2050, maybe it won't be exactly then, but we need to get off fossil fuels as soon as possible. We need to get to net zero as soon as possible. And this doesn't make any sense to me, because basically what it means is, it's saying, hey, we're impacting climate and that's having some negative things, so let's stop doing it as soon as possible. But the idea is, well, if we have, think of it as the climate change or climate impact is a negative side effect, or it's at least partially negative side effect of fossil fuels. So if there are negative side effects of fossil fuels or climate side effects, the idea is, hey, we should get rid of them as soon as possible. But that doesn't make any sense. When something has a negative side effect, that doesn't mean you get rid of it as soon as possible, because you have to weigh it against the benefits. And one of the key principles of thinking is just when you're evaluating products and technologies, you have to carefully weigh the benefits and side effects of your various alternatives. Like when you decide whether to take a prescription drug, you look at the benefits, you try to weigh them, the side effects, and then you compare that to the alternatives and you choose the one that's best. So when we're thinking about fossil fuels, we hear they have negative side effects. We can't just say, hey, let's get rid of fossil fuels as quickly as possible. No, we have to weigh them against the benefits. And there are three categories of benefits that we need to weigh them against. So one is positive climate side effects. Fossil fuels can have negative climate side effects, like more heat waves and rising sea levels. But they can also have positive climate side effects. One big one is more CO2 means more greening. Another one is a lot of parts of the world, it turns out every single continent actually, more people die of cold than of heat, so warming will save a lot of lives. We have to consider those. much more significant, we have to consider what I call climate mastery abilities. When we burn fossil fuels, one of the things we do is we power machines that keep us safe from climate. So storm warning systems, evacuation systems, but one of the most important ones is irrigation. Sorry, I'm gonna go back. So irrigation to deal with drought. So drought historically is the biggest climate-related killer. And a lot of critics of fossil fuels say, hey, fossil fuels have had an adverse impact on drought. But what's happened to how many people die from drought? It's gone down by a factor of 100. So in the last 100 years. So we are so good at dealing with drought through irrigation, but also ships that transport crops from one place to another so that you can alleviate the consequences of drought, that drought-related death has plummeted. So you cannot intelligently think about negative climate side effects of fossil fuels without looking at the offsetting climate mastery benefits. Let me just look for a quote here. So you need to look at the beneficial climate side effects, the climate mastery abilities, and then also the broader benefits of fossil fuels. So how does burning fossil fuels give you more food, clothing, shelter, et cetera, that you wouldn't get if you rapidly eliminated fossil fuels? So the broad method here, and this is how I'm gonna proceed, I'm just gonna follow this method. And interestingly, no one has ever refuted this method, yet I believe no net zero advocate actually follows it. So it's the factors I mentioned. You factor in the broad benefits of continuing fossil fuel use versus not. You factor in the climate mastery benefits, and then you factor in both positive and negative climate side effects. And that's how you get a picture of fossil fuels that can tell you what policy to follow. Now, the net zero movement, every single person I've seen who's a leader in that movement does not do all of these things. They usually do none of these things. So instead of factoring in the broad benefits of fossil fuels, they'll either deny them outright, say they have none, or they'll trivialize them, make them seem really small. In terms of climate mastery benefits, they basically just totally deny them. This is true of, it's definitely true of Tom. So I wrote about climate mastery on Twitter, and Tom's response was, quote, "Any child can understand the benefits of fossil fuels. It takes an adult to understand the downside," unquote. And then he added, "uninformed cocky pants." But I don't know that. But think about this. How does this make any sense? An adult weighs both the benefits and the downside. And in particular, you have to weigh climate mastery because that can offset and overwhelm negatives of our climate impact. So you have to do that, but it's pervasive, unfortunately. And it's really pervasive in actually every public expert institution that says we need to get net zero, they all ignore climate mastery. So one of the leading organizations in the world is called the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC. In their summaries, but even in their multi-thousand page reports, they do not once mention fossil fuel climate mastery and the decline in things like drought-related deaths. So think about this. This is the leading climate report in the world. Look it up for yourself. They don't even mention what happens to the climate death rate because it's inconvenient to their narrative. And people will say, like, hey, who are you to challenge these guys? And look, I wish these guys were being accurate, but I have to think on my own. And it's obvious to me that you need to factor in all these variables, and it's obvious that many of these leading institutions don't. So one thing, this is a common view about, like, hey, just listen to the experts. I definitely listen to experts if they're actual experts, but I need to listen to their reasons. Because often people who say they're experts are actually distorting the facts. So Tom says, quote, "climate risk is gauged by the preponderance of peer-reviewed evidence gathered over decades by experts across many disciplines. Consensus expert opinion, as reflected in groups like the IPCC, underwrites climate risk." And he was contesting, hey, you shouldn't listen to this guy. He's particularly criticizing me. Listen to these guys. And I would say, listen to the people who are actually dealing with all the evidence and have a good thinking methodology. I'm going to cite a lot of the science from the IPCC, but in terms of how they make their overall thinking about policy, if they don't factor in these variables, they are terrible thinkers. So we have ignoring the benefits, ignoring the climate mastery benefits, and then with the side effects, people deny or trivialize the positives. They almost never talk about greening or beneficial warming. And then with the negatives, they do two things. They tend to exaggerate the negatives. So like Al Gore will say, you know, we're gonna have 20 feet of sea level rise in the next few decades, and no science says that at all. So they'll exaggerate the negatives, but they'll also deny our ability to deal with them via climate mastery. And I call this catastrophizing, because you take a problem or a challenge, you exaggerate it, and then you ignore our ability to do it, and so you make a total catastrophe prediction that doesn't make any sense. So I'm just gonna follow this method. And in following this method, what I'm going to make sure to do is take on the best arguments of the other side. This is, and feel free in the question period, if you think of any others, please ask them, but I've done my absolute best to find all the best counterarguments against my position. And if somebody can actually persuade me, then I will certainly change my position. So let's start. So we're just going to factor in the broad benefits, then we're going to look at climate mastery, then we're going to look at the side effects. So factoring in the broad benefits. So the first counter to this is, well, there are no real benefits of continuing fossil fuel use because it can be rapidly replaced by mostly solar and wind. And my overall argument, which I'll show you, is no, fossil fuels are currently and for the foreseeable future uniquely cost-effective. Now, what do I mean by cost-effective? It has four dimensions. One is affordable, so that means people can afford to use a lot of it. Two is reliable, so it's available when we need it and the quantity we need it. Three is versatile, some flies trying to kill me. Three is versatile, which means it can power every type of machine. Most people don't realize when they talk about energy, but electricity only powers about 1/5 of the world's machines. The rest of them are powered by directly burning fossil fuels because that's either cheaper to do in the case of things like high levels of heat for industry, or it is the only way of doing it, like airplanes and cargo ships, they can only run on fossil fuels today. So the versatile is powering everything, and then scalable. Can they provide energy that's affordable, reliable, and versatile for billions of people in thousands of places? So I'm arguing, no, for the foreseeable future, only fossil fuels can do this on this scale. And so we need them. We need other things too, but we absolutely need fossil fuels if billions of people are going to have the energy they need. Now, the counter to this is no. And what happens, you'll see, is it starts from misrepresenting the current reality, and then it goes to misrepresenting the future. So I'm going to go through the usual chain that I get. So the first is fossil fuels are being rapidly replaced in an energy transition to solar and wind. And this is just not true. Fossil fuels are 80% of the world's energy today, and they're still growing, despite the fact that we have 100-plus years of aggressive competition and over 20 years of huge political hostility, and at the same time, big favoritism towards solar wind. So there's something special about fossil fuels that they are actually, they continue to succeed. And they're certainly not being rapidly replaced in an energy transition right now. Okay, so then people go to, okay, well, that hasn't happened yet, but it's going to rapidly decline soon because countries know that green energy will be cheaper. But the truth is, the countries that care most about cheap energy are pro-fossil fuels. The country in the world that cares the most about cheap energy is China, because they use that for many things, including they produce a huge amount of our green infrastructure. They produce a huge amount of the solar panel elements and wind turbine elements and battery elements. And interestingly, they use overwhelmingly coal. And not only do they use that today, because you might think, well, they're using that today, but of course they're just going to use solar and wind in the future because it's cheaper. No, they currently have 300-plus planned new coal plants. So 300-plus, that's more coal than the whole United States uses today. This is just new stuff that's designed to last 40 or more years. So they are not going net zero. They are recognizing that this is uniquely cheap for them. So this is more evidence that fossil fuels are uniquely cost-effective. And then the next thing you'll hear is, okay, but solar and wind, look, solar and wind are growing fast. And you can see like different charts and stuff that say, hey, look, solar and wind are growing fast. And so they're just going to grow faster and faster because they're just growing fast by outcompeting fossil fuels. That's what we hear all the time. But actually, if you look at the truth, solar and wind are growing fast only when given huge government preferences. They're given mandates, which means people are forced to use a certain amount of solar and wind. They're given subsidies, which means we're forced to pay extra for them. And then the most egregious that people don't talk about is they're given no price penalty for unreliability. So here's a way to think of it. Solar and wind work, you know, about a third of the time, and you don't always know when they'll work. Sometimes they can go to near zero. And yet the government requires grids, different grids under government policies, require us to pay the same for unreliable solar and wind electricity as for reliable natural gas electricity. This is as if the government passed a law that said you have to pay the same for a rental car that works a third of the time and you don't know when, and a rental car that works all the time. Just makes no sense at all, yet they get this incredible preference. So they get all these preferences, and there are these crippling restrictions of fossil fuels. So if you look at that, you see, wow, there's a growth, but it's a growth that's being pushed by the government. It's not a growth that's occurring where the government push doesn't exist. So I think this alone shows that for the foreseeable future, just nothing is close to fossil fuels in terms of providing low-cost, reliable, versatile energy for billions of people in thousands of places. But the advocates of rapidly eliminating fossil fuels, they have a bunch of further arguments that I think are designed to evade this reality. But and if Tom were here, I'm sure he would make many of these arguments, so let me just go through them. So one is just a general statement, hey, solar and wind are now cheaper than fossil fuels. Now, I gave you some counter evidence to that, like why is China using coal if coal is more expensive? Do they just not like cheap energy? But the truth is, and so Tom says, you know, clean energy now is cheaper than its fossil fuel counterparts in many regions and sectors. This is a huge exaggeration. For the overwhelming majority of the world's energy needs, solar and wind, they either can't do what fossil fuels can at all. So you can't say they're cheaper because they can't even compete, like airplanes, cargo ships, other non-electricity usage, or they're far more expensive. So it's just totally, anyone who says solar and wind are generally cheaper than fossil fuels is very misleading. Now, then the next thing you'll get is, okay, yeah, they can't do everything fossil fuels can do, but solar and wind electricity is getting so cheap that we're going to just start doing everything via electricity because electricity is going to be so cheap. So the 4/5 of energy that's not electricity, we're just going to rapidly make it that way because solar and wind will be so cheap. But if you look at solar and wind electricity, if you look at the full cost of the electricity, which includes not just the electricity itself, but the backup infrastructure it requires, then it's incredibly expensive. So this shows the Texas freeze in 2021 when power was needed the most, solar and wind were out to lunch. They went to 1% of their theoretical capacity, which means they needed essentially 100% backup. So what happens is places have to pay for both the unreliable infrastructure and the reliable infrastructure. That ends up costing a lot of money. So this is a total myth about it being cheap. Now the next thing, and this is one of Tom's favorite arguments, is that solar and wind with batteries will inevitably be super cheap because of increasing efficiency, driving lower production costs and then higher performance. So over time, factories, you know, will get better at producing solar panels and they'll make the solar panels more efficient at capturing sunlight. Tom puts it as technical cost curves do one thing over time, they come down, and performance curves do one thing over time, they go up. And this definitely has some truth to it, all things being equal. Assuming the mineral inputs don't change in price, yes, you are going to get more efficient. We learn how to do things better over time, and you don't have new regulation that slows it down. But this ignores two big things. One is you're starting from an astronomical point of cost. So if you say, well, the cost is going to come down, does that matter if the cost is incredibly high? So if you look at storage, so I've run the number because Elon Musk is always claiming that, hey, we can just power the world with my megapacks and some solar panels. We can just store the electricity. But if you're storing the electricity and trying to just use solar and wind, you need days worth of storage to have any kind of hope of reliability. I've run the numbers. For one day of world energy storage at Elon's best prices is $190 trillion. So $190 trillion is twice global GDP, and these batteries wear out after 10 years. So the costs are astronomical, so the fact that they'll go down some doesn't mean that much. And then also they have a very large mining component. These things are made of mined materials. And if we artificially scale them, so if we force people to use solar and wind or batteries faster than the market can really handle it, then the prices are gonna go up. And we've already seen this even with just a little net zero. People said solar and wind prices are going down, and they were going down for a while when you didn't factor in reliability. But now they've started to go up in part because the mined minerals have become expensive because we artificially scaled them. And again, we haven't even reduced the supply of fossil fuels yet. So this is a very misleading kind of argument. Okay, now they start to retreat to, okay, well, if we can't win on the price thing, well, at least we'll be more energy secure, right? We won't depend on Russia. This is just totally wrong if you understand where solar and wind come from, because we'll be far less energy secure. One reason is, if you try to use solar and wind, you're not gonna have much energy at all. So you're not energy secure if you have much less energy. The other thing is, you'll be far more dependent on China than you ever were on Russia, because China totally dominates the supply chain of solar, wind, and batteries, and they can cut it off at a moment's notice. Now here's a more plausible one that I'm more sympathetic to. Hey, we can use reliable alternatives like nuclear and geothermal. Those can rapidly replace fossil fuels. And this is something that we should absolutely pursue the potential of these and anything else, but they are nowhere near even close to provide, I mean, geothermal is tiny, and even nuclear, which I think has more potential, nuclear is stagnating right now. You can see it hasn't grown since 2000. We are nowhere near being able to provide all forms of energy with nuclear. I'm trying to make that happen as quickly as possible, but that's generations away. So net zero is not at all justified by this. And actually, many of the net zero people, not Tom, but many of the net zero people are also anti-nuclear, which is a big thing that's holding it back. Okay, now this is the final retreat. So you point out all the evidence that, hey, this is not actually cheaper, it can't replace fossil fuels, countries aren't choosing to do it, solar and wind are using government favors, they're not actually out competing anything, all these other things are myths. And then the retreat is, okay, we can't answer any of that, but there are some really smart people in academia who have rigorous plans to replace fossil fuels with mostly solar and wind. So the most famous guy is a guy named Mark Jacobson out of Stanford, and he has what he calls a plan to replace fossil fuels with solar, wind, and then some hydro. And he claims, hey, I've done this, I've run the numbers, and people find this intimidating, and it sort of makes them suspend the reality they see in front of them. So I've gone through the pain of reading through a lot of these plans, including Jacobson's, and they're really shockingly absurd. They involve many false assumptions, but two that if you just think about it, you can see that these are just jokes. One is they have an assumption that if we engage in unprecedented mining and construction, because all these plans involve mining and construction to a crazy degree, more than doubling per decade all these different minerals, which that itself drives prices up when you do an artificial scaling of things. And then they say that doing an artificial scaling of those things in today's political environment, which is incredibly anti-development, for instance, Joe Biden just said, hey, you can't mine in one of the best mining properties for green materials in Minnesota, and you can't do it for 20 years. So we're in the most anti-development environment in political history, and yet they claim it'll be cheap. So I'll say more about that in a second. And then at the same time, they say that untested schemes, so they involve all these things that no one has ever done, including technologies that don't exist, and they assume that they're going to be cheap everywhere the first time. So let's look at the mining thing. All these things involve more than doubling the supply of half a dozen major mined materials. So you can see this here. No one has ever shown me one example of any material in any political environment that has doubled in a decade. And this, they're saying it's going to happen for six of them, even though that we're in the most anti-development political environment in history. There's just no evidence for this at all. It's just a total crackpot fantasy. And then if you look at the plans, they involve these totally untested schemes. So for electricity, they claim, hey, somehow we figured out how to have solar and wind give us cheap, reliable electricity, when no one has actually figured out how to do that in reality. But they claim that they know how to do that. And then with other forms of energy, like for planes and cargo ships, they just make up vehicles that are going to somehow exist. So they say there are all these EVs and hydrogen vehicles, like a hydrogen plane, hydrogen ship, that are nowhere near commercial reality. And they're going to say, hey, in the next 27 years, this is going to replace everything. So this is absurd. And one of the things you can see on the slide is there was a refutation of Jacobson, and they talked about how it includes a wide range of currently uncosted innovations, so he doesn't give any cost to it, that would have to be deployed at large scale, including the replacement of our current aviation system with yet to be developed hydrogen-powered planes. And then they say multi-week energy storage systems that are not yet proven. So this is just an absurd thing. Jacobson sued the people who refuted him for $10 million, fortunately lost and has had to pay the cost, or someone has had to pay legal fees. But this is a joke. It also involved, and he just made up, that you could somehow take our hydroelectric dams and make them perform 15 times better at essentially no cost. This was just a made-up thing. So this kind of absurd thing, and yet it's cited all the time. And in Tom's book, Climate Capitalism, he says specifically that, you can see the quote here, but he says that Jacobson's, quote, rough and ready analysis demonstrates the possibility of going fossil-free by 2050. It demonstrates no such thing. It's totally absurd, and yet this is what is appealed to. Now, final thing is people say, okay, well, maybe we can just get net zero by capturing all the carbon. This isn't Tom's view, but this is some people's view. And the answer is we have no evidence that this can be done cheaply. You can capture CO2, but it's very, very expensive. It's worth exploring if people claim that they can make money by capturing the CO2 and using it in industry, and we can do that for some amount of it. But there's no evidence that most of it can be captured cheaply. And if you look at the current economics, we have something called the Inflation Reduction Act. And that has huge subsidies, including for carbon capture. So it subsidizes what they say is $85 a ton for CO2. And most people have no idea what that means when you say a ton of CO2. That kind of sounds cheap. But if you do the math, one ton of coal costs about $30. That generates 1.76 tons of CO2. So that means for $30 of coal, we pay $150 in subsidy if they capture the CO2. That is incredibly expensive. China and India are absolutely not doing that. So this doesn't scale at all. So I wanted to go through all of these because these are all the arguments you'll hear. Feel free to bring up any others, that none of them hold water. The truth is fossil fuels are and will for decades remain uniquely cost effective. So affordable, reliable, and versatile on a scale of billions of people in thousands of places. And what this means for policy is that if we have energy freedom policy, we can have cost effective energy for the whole world because we'll have more fossil fuels and more of other things that are cost effective. With net zero, we're going to have very little energy available to the world. So we have to realize that is a cost of net zero, having very little energy. Now the next question is, how much does energy matter? Because some people say it doesn't matter that much. When they have to admit we're going to have more expensive energy, it's going to be more scarce, they say it doesn't matter that much. And this quote by AOC really captured this to me. She said, the world is going to end in 10 years if we don't address climate change, and your biggest issue is how are we going to pay for it? So the idea is, well, if energy becomes more expensive, like who really cares? The planet is at stake. It's so much more important to reduce CO2 emissions. We're talking about the livability of the planet. The truth is how cost-effective energy is, so how affordable, reliable, versatile, and scalable it is, that determines how livable the planet is. Because the cheaper energy is, the more we can use machines. And machines allow us to be productive and prosperous. If we don't have machines, we have to live on the natural planet, which is a very inhospitable place. It's very impoverished, it has very few usable resources, and it's very dangerous. That's why historically we had a life expectancy of 30 and an average income of, you know, $500 adjusted for inflation. So energy allows us to make a naturally barely livable planet livable. And the more expensive energy is, the more expensive food, clothing, shelter, et cetera, is. So this is a crucial life or death issue. So if you're making energy scarce, that means you're making ultimately survival scarce and certainly opportunity scarce. Now, sometimes people say, hey, Alex, you're just overrating how important fossil fuels have been, because I'll point out, well, look, fossil fuel use perfectly, you can see CO2 emissions perfectly correlates to huge increases in life expectancy, income, and population, and they'll say, hey, that's just a correlation, right? That's just a random correlation. There's no causation. And correlation doesn't necessarily mean causation, but it can indicate causation. But people say, no. It's medical care, sanitation, scientific progress, and technological progress. Those are what have driven up life expectancy. And that's true in a sense. Those have all been huge. But they all are largely consequences of fossil fuels, because fossil fuels have, number one, by giving us all these this energy to become productive, and particularly to become productive in agriculture, we now have all this time to spend in these other fields that we used to spend literally in the fields, right? So it's freed up the time. And then all of these fields use cost-effective energy from fossil fuels to power the machines. And then finally, all of these fields use actually the materials of fossil fuels to make all sorts of plastics and other synthetic products. So you have to recognize, if you get rid of fossil fuels without a real replacement, you are going to make life miserable and shorter for billions of people. And it's common for people to just say, yeah, energy is not that important. And one comment Tom had is, he was talking about climate risk and how that's so important. He said, we live under an illusion of progress. I just want to point out, this is insane. We live in an era of incredible progress. I was born in 1980. When I was born, this is all adjusted for inflation, there were more than 4 out of 10 people in the world lived on less than $2 a day. Think about that. More than 4 out of 10 people lived on less than $2 a day. Thanks in large part to fossil fuels, which gave so many billions of people machines to be productive and prosperous, we now have less than 10% today. That is an amazing improvement. That is not an illusion of progress. And if you don't recognize how valuable cost-effective energy is, then you're not going to be sufficiently afraid of losing it. Now, the next refrain you get is, okay, well, let's say, yeah, energy is important, and if we eliminate fossil fuels, we're going to lose a lot of it, but that's not that big a deal because we can save a lot of energy via efficiency. You know, we'll do Zoom calls instead of flying to meetings, and we'll walk places, and we'll bike places. This is really an evasion of the state of energy. First of all, the people in the wealthy world, most people in the wealthy world aren't that wealthy by our standards. They need a lot more energy, but the vast majority of the world needs an incredibly large amount of additional energy to get out of poverty. So just to show you this graphic, so this is a third of the world is using wood and animal dung as their main fuels for heating and cooking. These people need desperately more energy and better energy. We have 3 billion people using less electricity than a typical American refrigerator. We have 6 billion people that anyone in this room use an amount of, 6 billion people using an amount of energy that anyone in this room would think was just totally unacceptable. So the world needs so much more energy. We just need to recognize that, which in practice means we need more fossil fuels. Now you get this final retreat, which says, despite all the evidence, hey, poor countries, they can leapfrog fossil fuels and go right to solar and wind. And people say, hey, look, we did this with cell phones, right? A lot of poor countries have cell phones, they didn't use landlines, so let's just do that. Well, the difference is cell phones have actually been able to replace much of the functionality of landlines around the world, so it makes sense to use it other places. No country has been able to abandon fossil fuels, even at huge cost, and every single country that has become wealthy or wealthier, including in recent years, so China, India, Singapore, South Korea, all these places have done it using fossil fuels. So if you're saying poor countries should somehow leapfrog and do something we can't, you are just using them as guinea pigs. And but it's not even a guinea pig, because you know how the experiment is going to go, and it's going to go really, really badly. So I think any time people bring up efficiency to pretend we don't need far more energy, that is just cruel indifference to how much energy the world needs. And I saw Tom talking about this, and I really did find this offensive, because he's talking about how we can reduce energy. And the way he puts it is, he was talking about Zoom calls, and hey, we can do Zoom calls instead of people flying to board meetings, as if that's gonna save so much energy. But he says, we rethink what we want, and if we act accordingly, we can still have it. But we won't be able to, for example, fly halfway around the world for a board meeting. We're not gonna be able to sit in our private jets and fuel it with biofuel and think we're green. Like, that's really how we're gonna reduce the energy? That's a very small amount of energy in the world. That is not displacing the incredibly large amount of energy that the rest of the world needs. And then he says, we're not gonna all have our own cars and drive everywhere we want. That's a flag to me. Those are choices to make, but they don't affect who we are, whether we're happy, whether our kids are going to be healthy. I think there are billions of people who would like to drive a car who would beg to disagree and who wouldn't agree, hey, it's a good thing if you can have a car and drive everywhere you want. So this idea of efficiency is gonna save us, this is not true. So if we look at all the facts, we see fossil fuels are uniquely cost-effective. Cost-effective energy is essential to our ability to survive and flourish on this planet. And we desperately need more of it, not less of it. Then fossil fuels are clearly there a near-term irreplaceable source of the cost-effective energy we need to flourish, which means live to our highest potential, have long, healthy, opportunity-filled lives. And what this means is energy freedom, under energy freedom, billions more have the opportunity to flourish because they can use fossil fuels. And in addition, other developing cost-effective sources of energy, whereas with net zero, we have billions of energy-starved people plunge into poverty and early death. And I mean this literally. If you take away the energy that powers the world, by far the most cost-effective thing, in a world of 8 billion people, you are gonna have absolute catastrophe. Really apocalypse. I mean, even just in food, we totally depend on diesel-powered machinery for food that allows one person to do the labor that it used to take 1,000 to do, and we require natural gas, which is the basis of fertilizer. You're talking about rapidly eliminating those with no viable replacement, you are killing people. And we need to recognize this. And so whatever you think about the dangers of climate, which I'll talk about next, you need to recognize that net zero is a murderous policy. So if you're gonna do it, it better be that climate change means the end of the world if you're gonna ruin billions of people's lives. And we're gonna see, fortunately, this is not remotely true once we factor in climate mastery. So the narrative around climate mastery, people will just call it adaptation, is this is not a very significant force, because they'll say, hey, our adaptation abilities are weak. They've already been overwhelmed by climate change. And you'll see the reports of disasters, and it makes it seem like, oh my gosh, it's getting worse and worse. Imagine what it'll be like in the future. The truth is that our fossil-fueled climate mastery abilities have completely overwhelmed any negative changes we've made so far, plus huge natural climate danger. And what this means is we can overcome almost any conceivable future climate challenge. So the first part of the counter to this is, hey, we're more endangered than ever by climate because of fossil fuel CO2 emission. This has just been in the media all the time. We're more endangered than ever. But we have statistics that measure how many people die from climate disasters. And they show very clearly we have a 98% decline. This is amazing. 98% decline in climate-related disasters, meaning your chance, anyone in the world has a 1/50th chance of dying from a climate-related disaster compared to 100 years ago. And it's very related to fossil fuels, heating and cooling, infrastructure building, irrigation, crop transport, et cetera. So this is a very powerful fact. Now, interestingly, there have been a few presidential candidates who have learned this fact, including from me, and it's been really interesting to see the media's response. So they'll show, they'll claim the decline in climate disaster deaths is due to storm warning systems, not fossil fuels. That's one of the main ones we hear over and over and over. DeSantis said something about the 98% decline in climate-related disaster deaths, and people said, oh, it's just storm warning systems. Vivek Ramaswamy had said this several weeks ago, and they said, oh, it's just storm warning systems. I don't know what universe these people are living in, because one, fossil fuels power the storm warning systems and the evacuation systems, which are a huge part of the storm warning systems working. And two, the number one killer that fossil fuels have reduced is drought, not storms. So this is just nonsense. Now the next retreat, or I'll do one more. Another one, and this is a lot of the catastrophists use this, they'll just say, hey, we have a disaster, and it's really bad. You know, Hurricane Ian, this is really, really bad. Not valid methodology. To learn if we're actually more endangered and if something would be made worse, you need to look at the trend. And the trend shows that we have a drastic decline in death from all these extreme weather events, which means any given weather event is better than it would have been because we're safer than we would have otherwise been. Now, if they concede, if the catastrophists concede deaths, they'll say, okay, well, even if people aren't dying now and even if they won't die as much in the future, we're going to do so much damage to climate. Like, climate is just going to destroy our infrastructure, so we'll just get bankrupted, so we need to get rid of fossil fuels to handle that. But the truth is, if you look at the data, climate damages are flat or even going down if you adjust for GDP. So this means you adjust for how much income and wealth we actually generate. Because the more income and wealth you have, the more damage you're going to have, because the more there is to damage. But that's a good thing that damages are going up, because it means that your wealth is going up. But if you adjust for GDP, what you see is it's actually gone down, even though we have huge incentives to actually take more damage. For example, government bails people out for living in risk-prone areas, so they take on more damage than they otherwise would have. Also, as people get rich, they live on the coasts in other damage-prone areas, even though it's riskier, because they think it's worth the risk. Whereas when you're really poor, you can't take that risk. So this damages thing is just another bogus argument. So you'll often hear, this is just a consequence of all this, you'll often hear, this is one of Tom's favorite arguments, it's cheap, it's expensive to adapt to future climate change, and it's cheap to mitigate. So mitigate means let's avoid the emissions. But the exact opposite has been true. We've used fossil fuels, and we've become wealthy, and we've become safer than ever from climate. So it's been very cheap for us to adapt. Versus restricting energy, restricting CO2, which means restricting energy, has been deadly. So here's something from The Economist saying, hey, expensive energy may have killed more Europeans than COVID-19 last winter, and Europe has been very much starting in the direction of net zero. So, summary of climate mastery. So we have these incredible overall benefits of fossil fuels, but also this incredible climate mastery benefit, which means we have these abilities that can deal with almost any situation. So if we have energy freedom to use fossil fuels and other forms of energy, we're going to get ever better at mastering climate danger, whether natural or man-made, meaning we can handle almost anything. Whereas with net zero, climate danger will drastically increase because we're going to go back to where we couldn't deal very well with natural climate danger. And then if we've added any, we have to deal with that as well. So we've dealt with the benefits, the climate mastery benefits. Now let's deal with the climate side effects, positive and negative. I'm going to focus more on negative just because those are where the arguments are. But it is important to focus on things like greening. So let's get the positive and negative climate impacts, and let's be precise about it. So the narrative we hear is, well, mainstream science shows that rising CO2 is an existential threat. That means a threat to our very existence that will soon cause catastrophe and then apocalypse. Just looking for a note here. So the way Tom puts this is, our vulnerabilities to climate risk are legion, universal, and ultimately existential. So like, we're not going to exist as a species or something very close to that. The truth is, mainstream science does not show this at all. Mainstream science shows that CO2 levels will lead to levels of warming and other climate changes that, if you factor in climate mastery, we can master and flourish with. And by the way, even the ones that don't factor in climate mastery, they do not say that it's existential. The UN science does not say it's existential. All of their scenarios, even with doing nothing to reduce CO2 emissions, involve us becoming a lot wealthier. So that's just a total misrepresentation. So one thing that's important is, because there's a myth that people have, which is that, well, if we hear an expert claim in the media from someone the media says is an expert, that's likely to be credible. And unfortunately, I wish this were true, but it's definitely not true. The claim is only credible if they factor in climate mastery, which is very rare, and then also if they don't engage in the practice, which is very popular, of distorting climate science for effect. So you can see up here, this is the New York Times taking data about hurricanes. They're trying to show hurricanes going up. They started in 1980. Why? Because we don't have data before then? No, because that's when there's an uptick in hurricanes, whereas if you went back in history longer, you would see there wasn't an uptick in hurricanes. So this kind of thing happens all the time. So you have to factor in climate mastery, and you have to have the source not distorting things. Okay. So the assumption people have that I think leads them to think that mainstream climate science means that we're going to have catastrophe is they have this idea that if we're experiencing more warming or storm intensity or sea level rise, that means catastrophe or worse. So this idea is if we're causing any negative climate change, that means catastrophe. But it doesn't mean that at all. Given how good we are at dealing with climate, we can only have catastrophe if the changes that occur in the future are totally different than the changes that have occurred so far. But we've already been impacting the climate for 100 plus years using fossil fuels, and life has gotten way better. So there's a huge burden of proof on the other side to say, hey, even though it's gotten amazing so far, we've increased the temperature, or we've contributed to increasing the temperature 1 degree, at 2 degrees, it's gonna be the apocalypse, or 3 degrees. That's a huge burden of proof given how much better it's been, including how much safer we are from climate. So the truth is, it's so powerful that for climate mastery is so powerful that for there to be a real problem, you need things like sea levels rising multiple feet a decade, twice as powerful storms, warming accelerating with no end. And science shows nothing resembling this. So let's start off with the warming. There's criticisms that it's going to get too hot, and then criticisms that, okay, if it doesn't get too hot, the climate is going to change in other ways. So the idea of too hot is, well, we should be scared about warming. So we've already gone up 1 degree. But 2 degrees, that's going to be terrible. 3 degrees, because heat-related death is already such a catastrophic problem. But even though we've gotten a degree warmer, far more people die from cold than from heat. Even in India, every continent in the world, more people die from cold than from heat. So near-term warming is expected to decrease death because more lives will be saved from dying from cold than caused by dying from heat. So this is important. Now, there's a worry about, well, is this going to affect the hot places the most? There's a narrative that the hot places are going to get the hottest. This is a direct contradiction to mainstream climate science. This graphic is from climate.gov under the Biden administration. And what it shows is that warming is expected to be concentrated in colder places, like northern latitudes, at colder times, like nighttime, and then in colder seasons, winter. So that means we're going to have even more deaths saved from cold versus caused by heat. And of course, we can address both if we have more energy everywhere. That is the main thing that is necessary. So we see just we get total distortions of what mainstream science says. Now, the next thing is, okay, even if it's going to be okay for a little while, the warming is going to go, you know, it's going to go exponential. And this is just a total contradiction to mainstream climate science and to the history of this planet. We've had 10 times more CO2 in the atmosphere, and the planet did not burn up. We have no way of getting even a quarter of the way there if we wanted to. So if the planet didn't burn up with 10 times more, how is it going to burn up soon? That's not how it works. What's called the greenhouse effect, which is the warming that occurs when you add more CO2 in the atmosphere, that's a diminishing effect. So it looks like this. And all the UN scenarios, even the crazy ones, admit this. So every molecule you emit of CO2 has warming, but it warms less than the last. So you have diminishing warming power, which means the warming levels off over time. So we're not going to be overheated. We're not going to be overwhelmed. This is all just pseudoscientific nonsense. Tom loves to use the expression, I think his favorite two words, as I read a lot of his stuff, is Mad Max. So that's like a scorching desert. You know, we're going to be this way. Mad Max. This is not anywhere in science. For example, we have agricultural productivity, which that would not happen with Mad Max. That's expected to dramatically grow, even if you have 4 to 5 degrees warming, which is very, very implausible. So this is just a total distortion. So I mentioned the catastrophizing comes from distorting the science and then distorting negatives and then pretending that we can't master them. And that's what Tom does, and that's what others do to make us really scared, in addition to denying the unique benefits of fossil fuels. So then the next category is, okay, even if we're not overwhelmed by the warming, we're going to be overwhelmed by other changes, like sea level rises and storms. And we'll see that this is not true. Even if you look at what's called the IPCC, which has a lot of biases and tendencies, nothing they say implies we're going to be overwhelmed by these things. So let's look at sea level rise. The extreme projections are 3 feet in 100 years. We're currently at about 1 foot per 100 years. That is not going to overwhelm us. We already have 100 million people who live below high tide sea level. Human beings are really good at dealing with sea level stuff, particularly if it's really, really slow. And our ancestors dealt with much faster sea level rises. So it's just not true that they're rising at this crazy rate. Now, what about storms? Well, hurricanes, the main cause of concern, we hear, oh, they're going to get so intense and they're just going to ruin us. But if you look at the science, it says they'll actually be less frequent and then 1 to 10% more intense if we hit 2 degrees warming. So that is not catastrophic. That's a challenge. That's definitely not a catastrophe. And I should mention, by the way, anyone watching this and anyone here you have cards to fill out, so I hope you put your name and email so you can get a lot of resources. But you're going to get access to all of this information, including references. Just anyone can go to alexepstein.substack.com, and all the references are here. So we're almost done. We hear this number of 2 degrees. 2 degrees is going to be terrible. This is just, we should see total science fiction. It was literally made up by activists to persuade people of things. The abilities that have kept us really safe at 1 degree are going to continue to do it 2 degrees and 3 degrees and whatever we happen to hit. So, summary of the climate stuff. Continuing fossil fuel use will lead to warming and other changes, but it'll be at levels we can master and flourish with if we are free to use cost-effective energy. So if we have energy freedom, CO2 levels will rise, but life will get better and better, as has happened over the last 50 years and 100 years, et cetera. If we go to net zero, CO2 levels will rise more slowly for the foreseeable future. They'll still rise, but you'll have billions of lives ruined. So there's no competition whatsoever. Now, one final wrinkle makes this even more decisive in favor of energy freedom, because actually in the long term, energy freedom is more likely to lead to emissions reductions. And the reason is because energy freedom accelerates the rate of developing cost-effective alternatives. The only way you're going to get cost-effective alternatives to fossil fuels is if you're a very wealthy society and a very free society, so you can engage in innovation. In fact, a lot of the work I do is working with politicians to help liberate nuclear and other things and make the grid fairer so that if solar and wind can do good, they can actually succeed on the grid too. Like, I do this because I want cost-effective alternatives to emerge as soon as possible. That's the only moral way to reduce global emissions, and it's the only practical way. And in practice, what we've seen is the two biggest instances of CO2 reduction that we've seen have come from energy freedom, not from net zero policies. They've come from nuclear, which energy freedom led to nuclear power plants being cost-effective until the green movement sabotaged them. And then also natural gas. Natural gas in certain situations, definitely not all situations, but able to displace coal, that reduces emissions by a significant amount. So the overall thing, net zero by 2050, the key error is it fails to recognize the unique benefits of fossil fuels, including the climate mastery benefits, is catastrophic when barely implemented and would be apocalyptic if fully implemented. Energy freedom gives billions more people the energy they need to flourish, and it unleashes truly cost-effective alternatives. So I really wish, you know, we could have had a debate tonight. I did my best to address all the arguments, read all of Tom's stuff, learn what he says, invoke his best arguments. It's not a substitute for him being here. Honestly, I think the biggest difference would just be he would have insulted me a lot more, and I'm not going to do that to myself, but he has called me, quote, professional sophist, intellectual fraud, disingenuous and slippery little eel, fully bought tool. And not only that to me, but to a lot of people I respect. So my friend Michael Schellenberger, who is an expert on these issues and I think one of the best thinkers, quote, there's no way Michael Schellenberger believes the shit he peddles. He's not dumb enough for that. He's a professional sophist who's carved out a living telling a particular crowd what they want to hear. So I hope Tom watches this, and I hope he gets some awareness given all the errors I've pointed out in his methodology, all the clear false statements he's made that contradicted reality. I hope that instead of just skimming my book and thinking my name is Ken Epstein and then trashing me in his book and misrepresenting my arguments, he pays attention to my arguments. But more importantly, I hope that all of you do and everyone listening does, because from my perspective, nobody has refuted this way of thinking about fossil fuels. The best people can do is do the straw man fallacy, pretend like Epstein thinks we should use fossil fuels forever, or Epstein says that because we used fossil fuels in the past, we should use them now. That's not my argument at all. You've seen that. I argue for carefully weighing the benefits and side effects, including the broad benefits of continuing fossil fuel use that we'll lose if we go net zero, the climate mastery benefits, and then precisely looking at the positive and negative climate side effects. And I think the facts totally justify energy freedom policies. So if anyone is willing to debate in the future, I hope you do. But more importantly, I hope you listen. Because I think that if you listen, you're going to be like most people. You're not going to want to debate. And that would be a good outcome. I only debate until I can just prove to everyone that these guys are wrong. But they're mostly afraid to come. For whatever reason, they don't show up. But I haven't seen any refutation of these arguments. That's why I'm doing this, not because I have some fetish for fossil fuels, but because I think billions of people's lives depend on it. So thank you for having me. Sorry we didn't have a debate, but this was the best I could do. And please, 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 please ask questions. And in particular, if you think there's a challenge to my views that I have not addressed and that I might not be able to address, I want to give priority to you. Thank you very much. So do we have any questions? And again, preference for any critical questions or any challenges.
As we begin our Q&A, if you could please form this line behind me next to my good usher here and give me your name, your job or major, and then ask your question. Thank you. Should I get in the line if you'd like to start? Pardon? Your name, your major or job, and then you ask your question.
Hello.
Hi. So
my name is Aaron. I am data analytics major at the high school. So first of all, I would like to say that while I agree that we need more energy, not less, in human society, I believe that the way to go for it is not predominantly via fossil fuels, but using nuclear power. Like, in my opinion, using fossil fuels is like putting a Band-Aid on top of Band-Aid instead of actually going to the doctor and getting the bones fixed. So
Is that your question? Do I agree with that?
Here's the question. Why do you propose for more fossil fuels in your speech? And why do you confuse the energy with fossil fuels instead of promoting use of nuclear energy and lobbying to make it easier to build more nuclear power plants?
So I try to say at least five times that I am doing a huge amount that I can to liberate nuclear energy. So I'm advocating, not advocating that people should use more fossil fuels as such, I'm advocating for the freedom to use fossil fuels. And my point is that what you need is enough energy that's affordable, reliable, and versatile for billions of people in thousands of places. What we have right now with nuclear is in a state of stagnation where it has become incredibly expensive due to the green movement. It is not scaling well, and right now it's just providing electricity. I want a world where nuclear is providing cheap electricity and cheap industrial heat and cheap kinds of transportation. And I'm fighting for that world, but we are nowhere near that world. I showed you the stagnation. So what I'm in favor of is the freedom to use fossil fuels so we can have as much energy now, and the freedom for nuclear to reach its full potential. If you talk about eliminating fossil fuels and trying to replace it with nuclear in the near term, that is just killing billions of people.
I don't see how it's killing millions of people if you want to replace energy with energy.
Because the wanting doesn't make it happen, yeah. Right? So here's an example. You can say, well, I want, let's say you hate silicon for some reason, which is the basis of modern semiconductors. You say, I hate silicon. I want all the silicon microprocessors to be replaced with germanium, and I want it to happen in 15 years. Well, the fact that you want that doesn't mean that it's cost effective to do. So you have to, and that's a lot more plausible than replacing fossil fuels with nuclear in the near term. So The issue is the way we decide, the way you resolve this. If you think you have some amazing idea and you can get it through, I will support you, but I do not support you in, if you're trying to rapidly eliminate fossil fuels by force. So I think that covers it.
Hi, I'm Spencer, environmental studies major. I think I just want to, thank you. I just want to quickly, clarify a couple things. So firstly, it seems like you say that fossil fuels are a short-term solution or near-term. What does that mean? How near-term are we talking? Is that you recognizing that in the long run we should transition to renewable energy?
No, so I definitely don't think in terms of transitioning to renewable energy. So that's what I'm making a philosophical point. There's no reason to favor, quote, renewable as such. What you want is the most cost-effective thing, and then being cleaner is an aspect of that. So my guess is that ultimately we'll use all forms of nuclear energy. What I want is for us to use the most cost-effective energy. When I say near-term, I'm speaking of the next several decades, because that's the time horizon of policymaking, and that's the time horizon we know things about. So that's what I mean. After that, it'll depend on what is the state of cost-effective alternatives. And if you look at the work I'm doing, I'm actually maximizing the chances of other things substituting for fossil fuels long-term because I'm advocating energy freedom in a lot of specific ways. But I don't have a prescription for it because it depends on what's actually cost-effective at the time. You can ask another one.
Sure. So cost-effective, and you bring this up a lot.
Yes.
But when you look up, you know, the data about what is cost-effective, the kilowatt-hour cost of energy, you consistently see solar, wind, offshore wind, hydro, natural gas, geothermal. Well, geothermal is higher up there. Point being, before you get to coal and natural gas and most fossil fuel sources, it's far more expensive. So the way that you justified this was this idea of, like, I forget the exact wording you used, repair costs, the other costs that's not accounted for. So where's that from?
So this is fortunately a thing that is changing in terms of how people think about it. So you'll see a statistic that says solar and wind cheaper, and it'll have usually the acronym LCOE, which stands for levelized cost of energy or levelized cost of electricity. Explicitly, you can see this on my Substack, levelized cost of electricity says, or energy says specifically, it does not factor in reliability. So the issue is with electricity, the cost of electricity is the cost of reliable electricity. So what we need is reliable electricity. So when you're dealing with an unreliable input like the sun and the wind, you need to look at the full cost. And when you look at the full cost, it goes up. So this is why, for example, Germany has some of the most expensive electricity in the world. They use some of the most solar and wind in the world because what they have to do to ensure reliability is they have to build two grids. They have to build a solar and wind grid, and then they have to build a very duplicative coal and gas grid. And Germany has had skyrocketing prices, but they've had good reliability. Now, what other places try to do is they play what I call reliability chicken. So they don't want these really high costs like Germany has, so they try to cut down on reliable power plants. They also try to cut down on resiliency measures, which is what happened in Texas, not weatherizing their plants enough, versus, say, Alberta the same week they had weatherization, they used fossil fuels, and they did very well. So what you have is, with reliability chicken, you're basically hoping the sun shines enough, the wind blows enough, it doesn't get too hot, doesn't get too cold. Otherwise, you're going to get screwed by your lack of fossil fuel or other reliable power plants. That's what happens in California. That's what's happening around the country. That's why you have all the shortages. So you need to look at the full cost. It's not repair cost. It's just the full cost for reliability. But this is fortunately starting to be less widely used. But for years, unfortunately, people have been deluded into thinking that they're cheaper when they're not. So they're not cheaper for electricity when you factor in the full cost, plus they can't do the other things fossil fuels can do. I highly recommend go to my Substack. I have the ultimate refutation of the argument that solar and wind are cheaper than fossil fuels. I have 70 very well referenced points on this. So thank you.
Hi, Alex. I really appreciate you coming by and doing this presentation for us today. I have a few questions for you, if that's okay. So one of my questions for you is, throughout your presentation, you mentioned a lot about climate mastery.
Yeah.
And with that, I was wondering, does like a climate mastery plan factor in such things such as like endangered species, invasive species, things that evolved with like an ecosystem of a like an area that you can't really put too much human influence on? I guess that's my question.
Does it factor that in? So generally, so climate mastery, so this is basically the use of energy and technology to neutralize climate danger and then also maximize climate opportunities, like things like even collecting rainwater as a form of climate mastery, or moving to a nicer climate during the summer as a form of climate mastery, in addition to all the ways of neutralizing the negatives. So the broader thing is environmental mastery. We can transform our environment and manipulate our environment more and more effectively over time. So anything that's valuable in terms of, you said invasive and endangered species, are somewhat different categories, but certainly with invasive species, the more energy you have, the cheaper it is, the more you can do about invasive species. And then in terms of endangered species, if you have reason to care about them, you can do a lot more to help any given species. One, because you have a lot more ability to change things in general. Two is because you're not dependent on the land as much. This is a problem somewhat for solar and wind, but particularly for what's called biomass, so wood in particular. A lot of species destruction comes from cutting down trees to get wood. So when you use underground energy, you're free from that, plus you have a lot of ability to make things happen. Now, the argument would be, what about, animals that can't deal with small changes in climate? What you find is the overwhelming threat to species is usually invasive species. Animals are already, temperature you can't think of, we talk about 1 degree, 2 degrees, but that is warming of a very dynamic range of temperatures. So all of these animals are already dealing with a very wide range of temperatures. So it is very unlikely that a relatively small shift in a huge range will be fatal to them. So those are the elements of it.
And then I guess another question I would have for you is, throughout my time in, I just recently graduated from college, and while I was in college, whenever professors talk about nuclear energy specifically, they would always mention how the main reason why we can't really resort to nuclear energy right now is because people are afraid of it, and that they have this fantasy that the nuclear facilities are going to melt down and all this areas going to get destroyed, and there's always a chance of that. So how would you address people's fears of nuclear energy?
So I think you really need to be aggressive about it and make very clear, nuclear is not only not the most dangerous form of energy, it is by far the safest form of energy. And the reason is because nuclear can't explode. The danger of energy, in terms of it being near you and causing an accident, is really some sudden event that happens. And you can have this with solar panels catching on fire and wind turbines going out of control. Those aren't huge issues, but those are issues. Certainly batteries we're seeing have a lot of issues with catching on fire. Of course, fossil fueled vehicles can catch on fire in different ways and plants can explode. But with nuclear, so in a dam, like a hydroelectric dam can explode and kill 100,000 people. So explode, so to speak, it can collapse. Nuclear doesn't have explosive events because the nature of when something goes wrong, which is extremely rare and we're very good at preventing it, we could talk about specific instances where things go wrong, but even when something goes wrong, a meltdown is a very slow event that people have a lot of time to deal with. The usual deaths that you have involving nuclear are not from radioactivity, they're actually from overly aggressive evacuations where older people are moved out of areas too quickly. So there's a lot more to say about it, but we have to make the point, and I've detail about this on my website, and in fossil future, nuclear is the safest form of energy. So if you want to be safer from energy, plus have no air pollution, essentially no water pollution, nuclear is amazing. And I think that needs to get out. And it's the people who have portrayed nuclear as dangerous, I think are very, almost uniquely dishonest. It's one thing to think CO2 is dangerous, because CO2 does impact the climate and there's a lot of uncertainty, so it makes, I get when people are afraid of that, even if they're overly afraid, but nuclear, we know the science, and it is not dangerous in the way people think, and there's a lot of disingenuous people who pretend it is. Thank you.
We're running out of time. It's just one question. Make sure your feet are on the tape. Name, major, or job, and then your question.
My name is Shrikar. I'm a master's student in computer science. I'm from India. So my question is, and by the way, just before I begin, my English is not that good, so please bear with me.
No problem.
So my question is not strictly based on science, because I haven't read up that much on climate science. My question has to do a little bit with politics, because don't you think the over-reliance on fossil fuels for the past few decades has led to America and other Western countries empowering very regressive regimes like Saudi Arabia or like Bahrain and Qatar, which do not, what do you say, they're not that big on human rights. So what I'm saying is, the availability of fossil fuels is very localized, as opposed to the power of sun or like wind, for instance. Do you think because of the this locality and because of this problem of having to deal with volatile states like Iran and stuff, and there's the Strait of Hormuz and you know all the geopolitics that this causes? Don't you think this is one factor that we need to consider, because of us not actively looking for alternatives for fossil fuels in the past few decades, we have led to empowering and enriching one of the most worst regimes of this world?
Gotcha. Yeah, really important question. So I think one thing is, if you're looking in this realm, it's a much more plausible argument for nuclear-based technologies than solar and wind. As I mentioned, solar and wind are totally dominated by China for the foreseeable future. So you can say the sun is everywhere, or even that is a little bit misleading. It's like America has very good sun in certain places and very good wind. Like if you look at South America, they don't have really good of either. Like there are large portions of the world that don't have really good solar and wind resources. And even if you do, the unreliability prohibits it from being like a real substitute. So with solar and wind and batteries, those are hugely China-based. I do think that for sure we should be, with all forms of energy, increasing our domestic capacity. So I'm a big fan of rare earth mining in the US, doing all these things so we have more potential to do those in a more secure way. Nuclear, I think there's a more of an idea that you could do it domestically. But the real solution there is what I'm advocating, which is more energy freedom. Take something like geothermal, which involves, you know, drilling into the ground. There are a lot of restrictions on drilling that are impeding that from happening. So the solution is liberate anything to become cost effective. The only way that China, India, and others are going to use things is if they're actually cheaper. So subsidizing things, subsidizing industries doesn't help. We could talk about subsidizing research. What you need is liberating industries so they're actually competitive. So you don't solve the problem by being dependent on China. Now, in terms of the problem with these other nations, it's a big subject, and it's not my current expertise, but I have done a lot of studying of it. The way in which we interacted with Mideast dictatorships was not at all inevitable. We made certain decisions to put people in power, and in particular to allow them to violate agreements and give huge amounts of wealth to dictators that we didn't need to do. So if you read a really good book on this, doesn't make a judgment on it so much, but I have a negative judgment, is a book, The Prize by Daniel Yergin. But what you can see is, for instance, you know, Saudi Arabia, when we first went there, the US and to some extent parts of Europe, but I think mainly the US, you know, they were having trouble finding water. Like that was the main thing. Nobody thought there was any potential. The government made deals with the West, say, hey, we're gonna pay you this if you do this. Like this was a deal. When Saudi Arabia, they were one of the last to violate it, but all these governments violated it and dictatorships were empowered. And I don't think we should have let that happen. And certainly, because you put all these dictators in power and then you make a lot of bad deals. So I don't want to minimize the problems with this, but the solution isn't like forcibly getting off fossil fuels. It's liberating domestic fossil fuels and other alternatives and having a better foreign policy, which is not my expertise, but we definitely need a better one. So thank you.
Okay, due to time, this will be our last question.
Oh, really? What? Oh, that's... What, are we getting kicked out of the room?
We are going until 8:35.
Okay, does anyone else have a good challenge? No, you can go, but does anyone after you have a really good challenging question? Okay, we got three. Well, I don't know if we can get an extension. Otherwise, you can come over to me at the table, but Well, if you think there's any particular amazing challenge after this guy goes, you can give it to me. Has he admitted any mistakes? Wait, no, hold on a second. I want this guy to go first, and then you can go.
Okay. Hi, my name's Al. I'm a political economy major at the University of Rochester. And also, I thought your speech was very comprehensive and great. So.
Thanks.
I think oil in particular, sort of similar to what the last guy said, is a problematic resource or issue to address, because a lot of countries might prefer buying components of green energy, so to speak, technologies from China over relying on Russia, Venezuela, or Saudi Arabia. All of the materials required to provide energy or to build energy-producing technologies are deposited around the world, but the problem with oil is that it is disproportionately distributed in unstable countries, namely Venezuela and Russia, with weak economies. These countries are either less reliable sources of energy because of internal strife, embargoes, misuse, or for some other reason, compared to China, which has a more stable economy, has been producing the world's goods without fail for several decades, and can do so cheaply. I'm not a fan of China, but I think it's important to understand why certain countries would want the infrastructure mined from areas around the world, as lithium deposits are not, you know, just concentrated in those oil-producing countries, but for instance, like a lot of South American countries are pretty dense in lithium as well. I don't know about other minerals, but understanding why countries would prefer to have, so to speak, green energy components produced and then, you know, sent, purchased for use in their country rather than relying perpetually on problematic states.
Okay, so most of that I think I covered in my last answer. I just want to add something I wish I had added, which is that I'm all in favor of these alternatives actually if they think these are good ideas. Like if somebody thinks like, hey, solar and wind, I don't mind that it's sourced from China. I don't think China has any hostile intentions, even though I think they've shown it in a lot of ways. They're not gonna, like, that can be part of their calculation and they should do it. What I'm saying is, but we need to be free to use what's most cost effective. So I'm not calling for the restriction of solar and wind. I'm saying we should be free to use these other things. And the main thing is, the security thing is just a detail. The main thing is, nothing is close to fossil fuels in terms of providing the energy that billions of people need. So that is the main thing that needs to be kept in mind. And then at the same time, yes, explore all these different alternatives, but if you want to pursue them, if you want to pursue any of the solar, wind, I mean, anything involving mined, like new kinds of mined minerals, we really need radically different domestic policy, which is something I'm working on, but we need to be able to mine a lot in this country. I think this is one thing Tom and I agree on. Like, we need a lot more ability to mine for things like lithium. Like, it's very important. Batteries are incredibly important for so many reasons, not just these fantasies of storing all your electricity and then deploying with batteries. Like, we want all of these things, and that's what I'm advocating. Okay, and it sounds like we had a question in the audience from Tom. So you can come. I'm just curious, though. I want to know, has Tom apologized or admitted any errors? Because that's part of how I judge people, and I found it really curious that he didn't apologize and took no responsibility for not being here, and then he didn't apologize to me for wasting my time. So I'm curious, has he admitted any wrongdoing? And I've pointed out many. So if he's admitted even two things, he'll go up a lot in my estimation. If he's just saying criticisms, then he'll stay the same in my estimation. So, but yeah, I'm happy to answer any question.
So originally I got in line to ask my own question, but for Tom, he said that it was the Syracuse University that canceled on him. He doesn't know why, he claims.
I'm sorry, just speak a little bit louder, I can't hear.
He claims that the Syracuse University canceled on him and didn't give him an explanation, so that's what he's saying. And then later on, he claims that solar and wind keep the Texas grid going, and asks, can we talk about climate risk? That's the only reason we conservatives want to reduce fossil fuel use.
He said we conservatives? He's
correct.
A conservative?
Apparently.
Okay, so the solar and wind keeping Texas, I'm surprised that is the thing he came up with. There's a really good piece on that at my Substack, so you can check that out. But what happens is, so in general, Texas is having constant electricity shortages right now. And it's not because of climate. We know how to produce electricity in all kinds of climate, a lot more adverse than Texas. The problem is Texas has been playing reliability chicken and not had sufficient reliable infrastructure, as I pointed out, for a long time, even before the crisis. So what happens is, on any given day, solar and wind will overperform their average. And then the advocates say, hey, look, solar and wind is powering Texas. Isn't this amazing? We can just use it all the time. I'm just gonna go back to this. Sorry, it'll just take a second. Because the Texas freeze provides an example of this. Let's see, a lot of slides. We're almost there. So look, the week before the Texas freeze, at one point, wind and solar are providing over 50% of the electricity, and the solar and wind boosters say, look, it's amazing, we're providing over 50%. People get the idea, oh, we'll just double the solar and wind, it'll be fine. But then look, a winter storm hits. It's not that the wind turbines freeze, the wind died down, there's not much sun during a winter storm, you go to near zero, but you don't have the backup that you need, and you haven't invested in weatherizing your infrastructure like other places did. And so solar and wind are out to lunch, and your fossil fuel infrastructure is insufficient and damaged, and then you have a catastrophe. So it is just so crazy to make the argument, to make this snapshot of when solar and wind happen to be performing well, that's great. That's like you have the unreliable rental car, and you show pictures on Instagram when it happens to be running, and you ignore when it isn't. You say, why can't everyone use my unreliable car? The other thing is, he uses the term climate risk like this magic incantation. So it's like, oh, can we talk about climate risk? I talked about climate risk for 30 minutes, and I talked about all the relevant variables. So what I want this to show is, like, nobody can actually refute the methodology, and nobody can refute the facts. And I wish Tom had figured out a way to make it here, but he can't do it. He can't do it. This is obvious from his questions. Nobody can do it, because it's just pretty logical and common sense. So anyone can come debate me and prove me wrong, but until they do, we need energy freedom, including we need more fossil fuels. Thank you.
All right. That was for sure our last question of the night, or at least for this Q&A.
And I'll be over there, by the way.
Yeah, if you have a question for him, just be sure to see him once we start to close this event. Thank you, Mr. Epstein, for this event and being just a great talent for this venue and answering so efficiently in your Q&A.
Thank you very much.